take a look at the picture on the screen. Here, if you remember our previous lectures, a magnifying glass that contains a convex lens is burning a piece of paper, as you can see. How is it doing so? The parallel rays of the sun that are incident on the magnifying glass is converged at this point on the piece of paper. In other words, these parallel rays are forming its image at this particular point of the paper, and the rays were converged and all this heat was focused at this point, due to which the paper burnt. Now, you will be interested to learn that the same magnifying glass can also be used to see an object in front of us in a bigger manner, or it is possible to use the same magnifying glass to magnify objects in front of us. So how is this possible? How can we use a magnifying glass to obtain the point image of the sun rays, and the same magnifying glass can also be used to obtain a magnified image of what's in front of us? We can thus conclude, right, that the image type, size, and its location is dependent on the position of the object. Now let us find out more about how we can determine the image type, size, and location. We can determine the location, type, and size of the image with the help of a ray diagram. How do we define a ray diagram? A ray diagram is a diagram through which we can define the location, type, and size of the image. Now, how is it done? A ray diagram is usually obtained by tracing incident rays from an object. We trace incident rays from an object, and after it falls on the lens, we trace the refracted rays. The point where the refracted rays meet is the point where we obtain the image of the object. So you must be wondering that there are many rays that are incident from an object. For example, if we consider an object like this, there are so many rays which are leaving the object. We have this ray, we have this ray, we have rays over here, and rays that are moving out in all possible directions. So you must be wondering that it is such a confusing deal to draw a ray diagram for this object, but you will be surprised to find out that we do not need all these rays. All these rays are not required. So let us find out what rays are actually needed. We need these rays. A ray of light from the object parallel to the principal axis, a ray of light passing through the focus or appearing to be incident at the focus, and a ray of light passing through the optical center. We can use all three of these rays or two of these rays, as we will find out later on. Now let us consider the first case. Here we have a convex lens and a ray of light is incident on the convex lens parallel to the principal axis. Now you will notice that the convex lens that has been considered is a thin convex lens. And because it is a thin convex lens, we do not need to consider refraction from both curved surfaces. Instead, we consider refraction at this central line or the middle of the convex lens. Now, a ray of light that is coming from the object and is parallel to the principal axis is getting converged at F2, that is the second principal focus. Likewise, for a concave lens, if we have a ray that is coming from the object and is parallel to the principal axis, after refraction, is appearing to diverge from F1, that is the first principal focus. Let us consider the second ray, that is a ray of light passing through the focus. So in the case of a convex lens, a ray of light that is passing through the focus, in this case F1, or the first principal focus, is moving onwards after refraction parallel to the principal axis. That is, once refraction takes place, this ray becomes parallel to the principal axis. Similarly, for a concave lens, we have a ray of light that is appearing to be incident at F2, or it is incident in such a way on the concave lens that it is appearing to meet F2. Such a ray, after refraction from the concave lens, will pass parallel to the principal axis. And the third condition. What was the third condition? We had a ray of light that was passing through the optical center. Now we have considered a very thin lens. So when we are considering a thin lens, this ray of light passing through the optical center passes through undeviated. That is, it does not undergo any refraction. Similarly, for a concave lens, we have shown a ray of light that is incident at the optical center of the concave lens. So once it passes through the optical center, it passes through without any deviation. So let's take a quick recap of what we learned. We learned that for drawing a ray diagram, we do not need to consider all the rays. We need to consider the rays, as we mentioned, parallel to the principal axis, passing through or appearing to pass through the focus, and a ray of light that went through the optical center. So when a ray was parallel to the principal axis, we found for a convex lens that it converged at a point on the principal axis. That is, it came towards the principal axis. For a concave lens, a parallel ray of light appeared to be coming from a point on the principal axis, that was F1. In other words, it diverged or moved away from the principal axis in such a manner that it seemed to be coming from F1. In case of the second ray, that is a ray that passed through the focus or appeared to be passing through the focus. Such a ray in the case of a convex lens, after passing through the focus, became parallel to the principal axis, or it came towards the principal axis, which is why such a ray became parallel. And in the case of a concave lens, a ray that appeared to be incident on F2 became parallel to the principal axis. And as we saw, both in the case of concave and convex, if a ray was incident at the optical center, it passed through the lens without any deviation.